Thank you very much, everyone, for coming.
We will just wait a few minutes while they reboot whatever the hell it is they've just done.
This talk came out of my perspective of the industry in the last 20, 25 years of software testing. Some of you may know I've worked in global roles in companies such as Google and eBay and looked at software engineering and software quality and how testing fits in that. What I've found is that, can you change the gain? There's feedback. So what we found is that there's very little to guide software testers. Some of you have taken certification, and maybe you think that helps. Some of you believe you're exploratory testers. Maybe that helps. Maybe it's test automation. But we don't actually know. There's very little evidence in the industry. And what I realized, it would be really great if we could look at what automation is starting to do better than we're doing, and what humans can do better to improve our work, especially given the increase in automation in software testing. Many of my examples will come from mobile, because I think it has some more interesting challenges, but the concepts and the principles apply throughout software. If you disbelieve, just put your hand up and challenge me during the talk, and I'll try and leave some time for questions at the end. If I speak too quickly, wave, scream, shout, cry, moan, something that tells me I'm going at the wrong pace. So let's start with a challenge for you. When we're talking about software testing, what are we trying to achieve? Is it simply want to do a little bit better than today? We know it's not very good. Just make it a little bit better, please. Do a bit of testing. Sort of, could you test this 20 minutes? Tell me what you think. Fairly informal. Are we aiming for perfection? No bugs in our organization. We're going to automate the hell out of everything. Are we looking for good enough, whatever good enough means for us? And typically, do we limit ourselves to what we know rather than learning techniques beyond what we know? And do we believe in our little bubble that this is the world that we know it in terms of software testing? The choices we make, the answers to these questions, materially affect what we do in terms of testing. So let's look then at machines versus human beings. Across the industry, hello? Of course you can, they're recording it anyway. Can I keep going while you're faffing around? Thank you. Right. So automated testing is getting much, much stronger, and there are businesses growing up around automated testing. This slide, when I drew it, was back in October last year, and there's a company in the USA called AppDiff, and what they do is they take apps, and I'll tell you more about that in a minute, but earlier this week I had a chat with an Indian company called Apache, and they're doing something very similar. So we can see one company, two companies, starts to be many companies, will be doing this sort of testing. There's no humans involved here. This is simply computers, and what they do is they download lots and lots of apps from currently the Android App Store because it's practical to do that. They take your app and they start testing it. They query the structure of the application. For many of us, we're familiar with the concept of a DOM on a web page. So the web page is a structural hierarchical object that we can interact with and say, find me the first text box. We can do the same with every mobile app. So we can query it, we can get information. In Android, it's called the hierarchy view. So what they do is they look at the structure of each page, and they effectively navigate through the application. They do it through thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of applications. So these are the thousands. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the app we care about. This is today's release. So it's the one that's in the App Store, version 2.98 or whatever it is. This was the last one. This was the one before. With me so far? Good. So they've tested this one, they've tested this one, and this one's now there. What they do is they compare every single screen, and they say, has something changed in the screen? Well, we can do that. But they can probably do it a little bit better and a little bit faster with computers and notice a little 1 pixel difference. They don't worry about whether it's right or wrong. What they tell you is this one's become bigger and more complex. And as you probably know, working with the DOMs, one of the challenges is, as it gets more complex, it takes more compute power to draw it on the screen. If you're using certain techniques to display your screen content in Android, like a list view, it takes lots of resources. They can tell you this. They also tell you the differences between the previous one. So you'd say, this little page now seems to be slower, bigger, fatter than the previous one. Maybe it was by design. Maybe we wanted to add the feature, but this just tells us that.
And they give us timing data, and they can run it on different devices, so we get different timing data for the slower devices and the faster devices. Again, maybe we care about this. Maybe it matters to us our app takes 5 seconds on a Samsung Galaxy. This is a comparison with our competitors. So if we're a shopping cart, in India you have several, in the US they have Amazon, etc., eBay. So you can compare against your peers and say, by the way, you're a little bit slower than they are on the checkout process. They also have a little bit of intelligence that says if you have a Facebook login or a Google login, they've got a series of accounts they can use for this testing. So essentially, this service is free. So you sort of think, hang on a sec, why are they doing all this for free? Well, how many of you have released an app? A few of you? An app with a couple of million users? Okay, a couple of million users. So we've got someone here who's got an app with a couple of million users. So you put the app in the App Store, and at 5 a.m., whatever time of day, it goes, it's available to users. It's automatically updated on people's devices, isn't it, pretty much? You realize about 2 hours later, something's going wrong, really wrong. They test this once a week. Wouldn't it be nice if it tested it beforehand? That's what you pay for, to get the information beforehand, not afterwards. The next thing, and this comes from academic work, and this is one example of many, but it's one I read about fairly recently, and the paper was published last year, so it's about 12 to 18 months old work. We have an application, the application crashes. Many of us who have mobile applications have something that automatically records the crashes. If you release through Google Play, it records the crashes and provides it back to the developers free of charge. So crash, big long stack trace, blah, blah, blah. That comes here. What they've done is they say, if we notice a crash in this application, we're going to send a command to a subset of devices that are running this application and say, please record the user interactions on the screen for this application. Make sense? The expectation is it'll crash again. When it crashes, they've now got not just the crash, but what happened beforehand. They look at that, they generate automated tests, and the cute bit is, with your permission, when you're asleep, which all of us do from time to time, they run the tests on the application again overnight while we're resting. When they're running it, they expect on the same device, if they've created a good automated test, guess what? We expect it to crash again, don't we, if it's related to the inputs. They run on different devices, because typically when we test, how many devices you got, the chap with a couple of million users? Is a bunch 10, 50, or 1,000? Okay, so he's got tens of devices. Trouble is, your users have got maybe 25,000 different device models. So what this does is it allows us to work out where the limit is. These all crash. These don't crash. What's the difference between these and these? Is it screen size? Is it version of the operating system? Is it this one's got GPS and the other one hasn't? Is it the chipset? You can learn all this by machine learning. You don't need us to sit down and do this on device number 17. Oh, you've got 18 devices. Hang on a sec. Let's do the next set of regression tests another hour later. So we need to find ways to do this. Now, there are similar concepts that are shipping commercially called heat mapping software. At least one I know of called AppSy. They do the same sort of thing. They essentially capture the screens every second, roughly. They create a slow speed video that goes nowhere unless a crash occurs. Then if a crash occurs, they give you the last sort of trace of what the user did. We can watch the video and say, ah, now I get it. Now I understand what went wrong. Key at this point, before I forget to mention this, is privacy. What's on our mobile devices tends to be personal. Some applications, so if you're doing banking online, having something that quite glibly debits $50 or 1,000 rupees every 10 seconds because it's testing to find a bug, isn't going to wear well with me. I'm not going to be happy with that. But for some applications, this is a very viable model, especially with the permission of the users, for free. Yes? On which bit, sorry? Sporadic crashing, yes, well noticed. We get all excited when we find a crash or a bug, and sometimes we believe it's because of our brilliant power. I typed in Julian asterisk star, funny character, press the submit button, it goes bang. So it's because, we assume it's because of what we did that the crash occurred. A lot of the work that's being done makes a bunch of similar assumptions, that the inputs matter. But what happens, and I'll give you an example, if the difference was a response from the server, not what the user typed. So I'll come back to that point, but well noticed. Next thing is something called monkey testing. Now, this comes from the concept that if monkeys just dumbly interact with the screens of our device, maybe we'll find something. And monkey testing is available for the main platforms. For Android, it's been built in for a long time. And I'm doing a PhD at the moment, part-time, in this sort of topic. When you see researchers, they always compare themselves with monkey testing because they think their super-duper double PhD-level research is going to get better results than monkey testing. Often it doesn't. Often monkey testing is actually pretty good. So good that this is the Google Developer Console, and this is one of the apps I work on, which is called QX. It's part of a Wikipedia project. If you're interested, it allows you to read Wikipedia offline on your smartphones and stuff. And we had release 30, 31, 32, and 33 going out there, and these are the internal numbers, and that's how Android works, and then you have a public version number. This is a nice little green bar, and what it says is it tested 11 different devices, tested our app on 11 different devices. In this case, in 32, we can see that 7 devices had issues. We had 4 that didn't have issues. And we can see here, if we click on that, we get a screenshot, and it says it's hard to read, but it says, unfortunately, QX has stopped. Okay, that dreaded okay button, which means you can't do much else. And very nice, they've given me a video. So I press that little thing, I've got a 15-second video I can watch. So I press that, watch it, and see what happened. It shows me the application starting up. Something happened. I wonder what that was. So let's compare that then. This is a passing monkey test, and this is a failing one. A couple of differences, we can still see the application screen. This is just a list of different Wikipedia databases. You can see a keyboard's here, so the monkey's stopped at this moment. It's put in thousands of events. We can see a video running for 5 minutes and 15 seconds. It's typically just over 300 seconds it runs for. This one we can see, it was 15 seconds, and we've got the video to watch. We can see the differences in the device. This is the Nexus 5. This is the Motorola G first edition. This one was set to Hindi. This one was set to English. So we can see there's some differences so far, can't we? Let's go back to the list of failures. Does anyone think they can see a pattern here about the fails versus the passes? Android version, well done. So the Android version, when it's 4.4, seems to relate to the failing activity. We move along here, and we can see, well, 3 of them have got what seemed to be the same error message. And Android has this way of laying out the screens in something called XML, and it's rendered at runtime. So it does something called inflating the XML to make the screen as we see it and love it. And this is button. So what it's doing is it's displaying a button. Now, Android has been able to display a button since the beginning of time. So what's the big deal? Libraries didn't work very well on 4-point-something devices. It actually had a number of bugs, and if you went onto Stack Overflow and read the bug reports, you see lots and lots of complaints saying, if you use this library on 4-point blah, it causes problems. Let me go back a minute. Do you remember I said we've released our application? And we're doing updates? We tested this application, but we hadn't found this bug. We hadn't got round to thinking, oh, let's remember to run it on an older device. Stupid us. But thankfully, they caught it for us. On the other hand, Android is, and the test runner isn't perfect because they're all the same bug. All of them crashed at exactly the same point, but the reporting's wrong. So once we saw this, we were able then with the developer to say, hey, it seems to be something to do with Android. He went and had a quick look on the Stack Overflow site. Damn, okay. We changed the little way we did the layout. Fixed the bug, updated it in the App Store. Next day, we had the new release out there. So sadly, it affected some users. We actually got some good correlation from reviews written by users. A few users had downloaded it and said, hey, it crashes on my device when I press the settings button. And that's all that was happening. The monkey was pressing the settings button. We hadn't bothered doing that in our testing. Next thing, and this is coming on to your point. Most of you have heard of a company called Microsoft. Yep, good. Do you know that Microsoft still make mobile phones and an operating system? And it has a few users, a few million users. They own their own app store, like Google effectively owns the Android, Google Play Store, and Apple with their store. something fairly clever. They looked at every crash in a year, 25 million or so of them, and they went through the crashes and said, is there anything in common with these crashes? And what they decided, and I'll show you more about this in a minute on the next slide, is they essentially analyzed all the crashes and looked at ways they could reproduce these crashes using automated testing. The paper is a very good paper. It's freely available. If you search for how to smash the next billion mobile app bugs, that'll get you to the right paper. And before I forget, the slides are available for you, and also the screen isn't available. Never mind. Something weird and wonderful happened there. My computer's semi-happy. It looks like it thinks the HDMI is gone or something's wrong with the HDMI projection. Okay, I'll keep talking and hopefully we'll come back to the slide in a minute. Okay, we're rebooting the projector. What they found is roughly 90% of the bugs came down to 10 common problems. I'm going to ask you whether you know what an HTTP response code is. Anyone know these things? Can you give me an example of an HTTP response code? 404. Good. Anyone else? 500. Anything else? 200. Right. So what do app developers do when they write software? They assume that when they make a network request to get their clever JSON stuff, it's going to come back and not have an error. So they assume this will always happen 100% of the time. But guess what? Sometimes it doesn't happen. Sometimes something goes wrong, and perhaps it's 0.1%, that's 1 in 1,000, perhaps it's 1%, 1 in 100, perhaps it's 10% on a bad day. But every time that they didn't handle the response correctly, what did the application do? Crash. Simple as that. So Microsoft used a bunch of smarts. They know their platform. They were able to query the structure of all the applications. They tested about 3,000 applications. And with these applications, they automatically generated test cases that generated the crashes. The really clever thing that they did is they had what they called fault-inducing modules. And the fault-inducing modules were able to do things like injecting a non-200 response code into any network message that came back. They're able to emulate an impatient user. Now, I'll stress all this testing was automated. There wasn't a human writing test cases. There wasn't a human doing the testing. It was all running in a vast collection of servers, a bit like AWS, the Azure cloud and stuff. What they then did is sent back to the developers the test cases that reproduced the failure and said, just so you know, your app's in our app store. Thank you, we love you. And here are the crashes, and here's how you reproduce them. So given we've got this in the industry, and this is definitely exists today, they did the work probably a year or two ago, when we're sitting down and we're saying, we're a great mobile phone tester, we can sit there and do this, well, monkey testing can do this, we can automate it and do it a lot faster than you can do it. But perhaps there's still something that's there that's worthwhile for the human beings to do, such as getting the projector working. I'll wait 30 seconds before moving on to the next topic, because I prefer to show you the slides. That was a technical to get a 200 response code from the projector. So I'm going to escape out of presentation mode, which will take about 30 seconds for my glorious laptop while it's getting confused, until we can get the projector working again. And then I'll continue with the topic. While we're doing this, by the way, my computer goes into a little loop for about a minute. So it doesn't actually let me do anything while it's fighting with the projector. All right, I'll move on, and I apologize if I end up doing this out of sequence. The next thing is, how many of you have heard of exploratory testing? Anyone not heard of exploratory testing? So the concept of exploratory testing comes from work about 20 years ago by two people, James Bach and Kem Kaner. Kem Kaner is a professor in computing and in law in Florida, and James Bach is a fairly well-known software tester. And if you haven't met or known about him, then do look him up and his work. Similar with Kem Kaner. which is CEM, by the way, Chem Kana. So they came up with this concept called exploratory testing. How many of you have heard of ISTQB? Not many of you, okay. So ISTQB is the International Software Testing Board, and the concept of this, which came around 10 years ago, and there's an older UK-based system that predates it, is that people can take tests to demonstrate some level of competence in a subject such as software testing. They have a whole bunch of other ones. And it became an international one rather than a UK-based one, and they have different levels of certification. So there's a perennial argument in the industry is if someone has got the certification, they're qualified, whatever that means, and if someone believes that they don't need a qualification, which one's better at testing? Make sense? So there's some research done with 20 people who'd got the certification, 20 who hadn't. It was actually done in the UK. And for those of you here earlier this week, Isabel Evans was speaking here. She was one of the people who was actually in the test, I found out afterwards. So what they did is they compared the faults that they found, and they found that the people who'd had certification had a structure that enabled them to continue testing when the other ones petered out, but the exploratory testers tested more broadly and found more interesting bugs. This is a fairly early piece of research, and by that I mean I wouldn't stake my life on saying that either A or B is better. However, it's very clear that a combination of having some structure can help us, providing that we don't become blinkered and limited by the structure. And one of the biggest weaknesses or challenges I see with any certification scheme is that it has a tendency to help us think within the bubble and say, oh, I know what that technique is, it's called boundary value analysis. I'll use boundary value analysis rather than finding other ways to do our testing. Have we got any hope of this working? If necessary, we can flip to VGA. Okay, thank you. Oh, we can do it that way. If not, I've got a VGA, VGA adapter, because there's VGA here, or there was VGA here. Oh, no, that we need the mini port, if that's what we're going to do. We'll put that in first and see, because otherwise I'm going to have to go and raid my bag, and it'll take an extra minute. Sorry? Yes, let me take questions. Good idea. Yes. So the question is, when there's a crash, I'm going to sort of say what you said, and I'll try and rephrase it. So when there's a crash, perhaps there's also a problem with asking for permissions. And does this thing I showed you, is it just a concept or is it real? So it's real. There's many, many things we need to think about when running a mobile application, in such as with the newer versions of Android and with iOS, the user is asked for permissions. And how many of you work with Selenium and WebDriver? The standard sort of web testing frameworks. Quite a few of you. So you're familiar with the same problem of dialog boxes popping up that you have to sort of blindly hit OK to. Well, the same can hold true for this. Now, with the mobile platforms, typically, they're easier to interact with. Now, I'll tell you why it's easier to interact with. Is anyone here for the keynote a couple of days ago from ING? There's a chap from ING. Is there one thing that you remember about the speaker? The speaker was blind. So he couldn't see the screen. He can't see anything. But he still uses technology. So how does he use technology? He uses something called accessibility layers and text-to-speech, and it speaks aloud to him and all the rest of it. And there are millions of people who need this help in the devices. It enables them to live better lives. It's not limited to visually impaired people. It can also be good for us to listen sometimes to our phone instead of looking at the screen, like when we're driving. We'd prefer it to tell us turn left or turn right rather than us to have to look at the screen, wouldn't we? So the device can talk to us. Well, both of the main platforms have standardized an accessibility layer, and this accessibility layer allows us to interact with anything on the screen, because otherwise, how would the accessibility software work? So that will enable us to always find an extra dialog button, click on the dialog button, and then continue. So that is a problem that can be solved. With the Microsoft work, they picked 3,000 applications, And I don't know whether they met any problems or not. They didn't report that in their papers. They've written a series of papers on this topic. And academic papers are typically about 10 pages long, a fairly dense text. So they may not have worried about that, or perhaps they ignored a few applications. But it's a solvable problem. I have no doubt about that, to do this. The more important problem is, particularly if you have applications, you know that only a tiny percentage of the errors result in crashes. There's lots of problems to do with usability or missing elements. None of these have crashes. And this is one of the areas where human beings can actually help augment the testing done by humans. One of the things we used to do back in my days at Google is we used to automatically test all our applications overnight, and we'd take little screenshots of them. And we'd have thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of screenshots every day. The human being is extremely quick at comparing them. Now, a computer can compare them pixel by pixel. That's dead easy. Do they every pixel match? Yep, done. Yep, done. It's the same as yesterday. Probably okay. We'll assume it's okay yesterday, it's okay today. If we see differences, occasionally we can detect differences and say, we're pretty sure that when we see this difference, something bad has gone wrong. The error message dialog has popped up. But sometimes we're not sure whether it's right or wrong. Examples like the app diff, it doesn't know whether we intended to change the UI or not. It just tells us it did, and it allows a human being to use it, make the informed decision. So that's all part of this. And typically, automation only checks a subset of things. What I'm trying to challenge us to do is to think about how can we use automation in ways that we no longer need to do that testing so much, because it will find out a lot more for us. It will test broader, faster, and deeper in certain areas, and then we can refocus our testing. So I'll talk about a little Indian company here. Some of you will have heard of a company called Mulya. They're based here. And one of the things that Mulya have been experimenting with are guides to help people test more effectively. I think it's still in the prototype stage. I played with it in the prototype stage. For those of you who've tried exploratory testing, one of the concepts that people use for exploratory testings are little combinations of letters that help us to remember types of testing. So I want to make sure I test the platform. I want to make sure I test the data. I want to make sure I've tested the functionality and the operations. And that becomes a little acronym, which is known as San Francisco Depot. So structure, function, blah, 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 data, et cetera, et cetera. There are now hundreds of these, including quite a few that have been created, such as I Sliced Up Fun, for mobile applications. So far, so good. When we look at testers, and I talked to a lot of the testers at Mulya over the years, and I tried to get them to tell me how effective are these. If you're asked to test C communications, which is used in one of these acronyms, do you actually find real bugs or not? Because all of us have got limitations in terms of time and stuff. But very few people go back and record, when I was doing the data testing, these are the types of problems I found. And next time I test an application that's similar, I want to make sure I test data because it seems like there's certain classes of bugs there. So what they've done is create a prototype, and again, until the computer does something. Do you want me to reboot the computer? Well, let's just do the big holding down the button for every day. And then after every day, we press the little button, magic happens. So normally, I have two laptops with me, by the way. The other one's one of these super cool MacBooks with a USB-C that almost always hangs when I plug a projector in, which is why I brought the... This is 5 years old. I thought even a five-year-old laptop would cope, but perhaps not. Anyway, when it logs in, I'll type in all the rest of it, and we'll hopefully be back and running. This is fairly quick normally on a Mac. And it's another couple of minutes waiting for PowerPoint to be happy. So let's just log in. Give it another minute before we plug the projector in, otherwise it'll go horribly, horribly, horribly wrong as my 4,000 browser windows now try desperately to connect to the internet, and I've turned off the Wi-Fi. So when it's finished with all that, we'll plug the projector in and go to PowerPoint. So what they've done is they've created a tool to help us guide the testing and collect the results of the testing that we're doing. It's fairly early stage work. It's not just a prototype. A lot of the ideas are not yet built into the tool. But what I'm hoping we'll start doing is we'll start mining data. I'd mentioned to you Microsoft. Microsoft Research, in my view, are doing some of the best research in the industry in things like testing mobile applications, and also in software analytics. Now, software analytics is a broad topic. It says everything that we do on a computer is digital. Every key we type, every time we file a bug, every time we check in code and stuff.
So let's see, we're going to do this one, are we? Yay! Right, so, oh, good old rebooting the computer, I think, actually. Oh, this is the old version of the slides. Oh, no, it's not. This will do. Okay, that's things. So I'll go fairly quickly. This is San Francisco Depot. This whole long list is taken from some websites that's meant to help you think about testing. So I just threw these in between them. And what you can see is there are tens of different words we can think about. So what happens if something's absent? What happens is about sequencing, concurrency, where little bugs happen, et cetera, et cetera. Remembering while you're taking pretty pictures, you can actually have the slides. So this is the test analytics stuff from Mulia. And the idea is that you sort of fill out a little template of the sort of things that you want to test and wanting to focus on. It allows you then to pick some of these models, these heuristics. And in this case, I particularly want to test this one called spies. It provides little guides for people on how to do this testing. I mean, all this is available on the internet. You could do this by yourselves. The difference is in the data collection. So in this case, I'm picking this one called spies. And why am I doing this? I'm doing this because I wanted to test searching and things that affect searching are things like special characters. It turns out in our Wikipedia application, our searching is very weak. It's got lots of limitations in it, one of which is it requires you to type everything in the right case. Now, for English, most of our words are in lowercase unless we start a sentence or unless it's someone's name like Julian or the name of a city or a country. So we're fine with this, pretty much. Not perfect, but we can kind of cope. But in languages like German, where they capitalize every noun, it becomes a big deal. And it turns out we're getting lots and lots of grumpy users who spoke German. Because town names were normally compound words like Selam Z, and this Z is actually a Z. The weird thing was the first character we searched case insensitive. Now what this happened is it fooled the user into thinking, ah, they don't need to worry about case, because when I type in the first letter, it kind of works. It starts giving me search results, and I can see what I'm looking for in the search results. As I type more characters in, then the result disappeared. So cutting long story short, for the testing, that's the sort of thing I wanted to focus on. This is an example of how it sort of helps guide me through the testing and make sure I cover the different areas. And then we've got some sort of reporting showing the progress, and this is where we start to learn from the data. So I want to talk a little bit about analytics. My PhD is in using analytics to capture information about how the mobile apps are being used, because I believe it can help improve the testing and development practices. One of the nice things is we're no longer limited by our thoughts and our understandings of the users. We're actually getting real data from roughly the whole population. So if we've got 2 million users, we're getting data from roughly 2 million of them. For those of them who are in flight mode, who haven't got a Wi-Fi connection, they're blocked by the proxies, maybe we don't get their data. Maybe get sent to them when they're not sent to us when they're next on the network, depending on the libraries we're using. But roughly, we're getting 100% of the population. It's virtually free to collect the data, and hopefully, it can help improve what we're doing. So I'm looking for how could we use this, for instance, to help improve the testing that we're doing, to give us guidance. I've mentioned this Microsoft model, so this is probably worth spending an extra minute or two on. When we look at the work we do, given that we've got all this data, like all our bugs in the bug repository, we tend to spend our life here. We run reports and we say, how did it go last release, last sprint, whatever it is? Oh, well, we got one sev one, it wasn't too bad. We got three sev twos and a bunch of sev threes that we'll never look at again in our lives. But we don't necessarily look at the factors that caused this. What was the reason that we had a sev one? Was it because we didn't think to test on the older Android device and test the settings like we had? Was it that our people didn't have the skills, the knowledge, or the understanding? Was it a bug in the understanding of the developer and how they wrote the application? So once we start to look at this, we can look for common factors and hopefully address the common factors. Again, I think I mentioned this one briefly. When you release software, if you've got a production system, you're running in the cloud, et cetera, we've made some changes. We need to look at the real-time alerts that are happening right now, this second. And Naresh came to my workshop on Monday and ran out again because something was going wrong right now. So guess what? He has to go and solve the right now problem. So we know that something's wrong, but we then need to decide what to do next. Now, with a mobile app, typically we have to decide, can we disable the new feature if necessary? There's some toolkits that allow you to do that.
do we stop new users downloading the application? Do we essentially pull it from the App Store and just let them download the old one, not the new one? Do we wake up our developers, who sadly were awake till 2 a.m. making the release happen? Do we wake them up again and say, hey, can you come back into the office because we've got this crisis going on? Do we staff customer service with more people who can answer the call and say, yes, customer, we know it's wrong, we're really sorry, we'll make sure we fix it? Do we have people go into the App Store and when people are writing the rude one-star feedback, they respond saying, actually, we do know about the problem, thank you very much for telling us, we're working on it now, and please come back later on today and see if we've got the update. We think we'd have it ready for you in a few hours, subject to the App Store. This becomes really important because for anyone who uses mobile apps, you're familiar with the concept of ratings? And how many of us will install an app with 2 stars? Forget it, why would we ever do that? You know, so we're taking the wisdom of the crowd to say, this app is crap. So it's actually a difference of 0.1 in the ratings can materially affect your app by about 10% in terms of the downloads. So it affects the search orders, it affects the in-app purchases. I haven't got time to go into the details, but it really matters. So when you're responding to your users, what happens is you were the person who wrote the first 1 star. Your app stinks. We've responded to you and said, thank you very much for your feedback, whatever your name is, Jack, Fred, you know, we're going to deal with it in the afternoon. And you've just found the same problem. You're coming on the App Store to give us 1 star. You want to make sure it hurts. Now, if you see the response to his one, you say, oh, they're dealing with it. I don't need to file a report anymore. I'll just come back in the afternoon. If, on the other hand, you saw his complaint, you think there's nothing there, we haven't bothered responding to you, you think the lazy, good-for-nothing developer, I'm going to make sure they pay attention, I'm going to write 1 star, and you're going to write 1 star, and you're going to write 1 star, and we're all going to write 1 star because we want to make sure they wake up and fix the damn bug now. Now, 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 now. A bit like I wanted to fix the projector. Now, 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 now. So this is really important for us to deal with. So sometimes the recommendation is the important side of it, not just dealing with the alerts. Future. We all like predicting the future. So the weather's going to be warm and sunny tomorrow, probably, since we're in Bangalore. We're going to forecast the growth curves of our application, 10% more users, 20%, 30% more sales. And we kind of expect this to be linear. By that, I mean if we have more users, perhaps we need more servers. But it seems like if we have 10% more users, maybe 10% more server capacity. Seems about right, doesn't it? But sometimes we cross a boundary where the behavior of the system becomes different. Most of us have water that comes out of taps. So as we start turning out a tap, we get little drops of water. And as we turn it, we get bigger drops. At some point, we turn it just a little bit more, and it changes from drops to a stream. But it's a fairly smooth stream coming out of a tap. And we keep turning it on. We get more water and more water. It stays into a stream. And eventually, it becomes turbulent. It starts sort of spitting out and going all sorts of weird places because the water dynamics change at 2 different transition points. If we boil water from ice to heating the water to steam, we see transition points. The same sort of things happen in computing. While we're running within a resource, let's say it's available RAM, the behavior is pretty much the same. It may vary by 20%, but in the grand scheme of things, 20% isn't a lot. When it runs out of available memory, it says, I have to put some of this on storage, and that takes microseconds, milliseconds, even seconds to do. The behavior changes by an order of magnitude, 2 orders of magnitude, 3 orders. An order of magnitude of 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, to make this clear to you. So a bit like my computer going stupid, it went really stupid. It wasn't going to recover by itself. So what we want to do is to do things like failure prediction models based on this. We're looking for the insights. I have about 5 minutes later, so I'm going to speed up a little bit. I'm looking for 2 types of things. I'm looking for testing based on information. So if I know that my app's being used in Hindi or Gujarati or Tamil or whatever, perhaps this matters to me. Perhaps I can change my testing and make sure I include the more popular languages. If I notice there's a Xiaomi phone that I don't have in the UK, perhaps it's worth me doing some testing on a Xiaomi, either by renting one remotely over the internet and testing by the hour on the big server farms, or perhaps I buy one and take it home with me. Things like setting the locales, looking at the user flows as they navigate through the application. I can't predict how you're going to use my application. I can guess. But once I know how you use it, I can make sure I reflect that in my testing. We've talked about the crashing. And what am I trying to do? I'm trying to get to fast reproduction. I want to be able to reproduce a problem quickly in my own environment. The moment I do that, I have a chance of being able to fix the problem rather than just guessing. And that's what we saw with the pre-launch report and our application. The moment we saw the problem, we kind of knew what to do and fix it. The insights, is the stuff that's non-obvious. So things like the rate of change, we suddenly know that usage is going down on these devices. Huh? Did we expect that to happen? Maybe something's happened, like our app no longer installs properly on these devices. Does it matter to us? We're not getting data back. And sometimes the absence of data is as important as the availability of it. I've mentioned about the threshold. So what we're trying to do now is maximize our learning. This is part of my research. Sorry, it's a bit faded here, but essentially what I'm looking at doing is taking the analytics. Events are things like the update of Android, for instance, a new device being launched, a bunch of tests that we already know and love or hate, and be able to recommend things like run these tests first, don't need to run those ones, and actually generate new tests. So I'm doing some work in that area at the moment. So if you're interested, by all means, get in touch. This is to remind you, and again, sorry, it's a little bit faded on the screen. This book is called The Glass Cage, which is should be written there, but it's too faded out. And the question is, who needs humans anyway? Most of you have been in an airplane. The airplane has automatic pilots. So the automatic pilots have been around for about 40 or 50 years. They've been commonplace in things like the Airbuses for the last 20, and Airbuses fly by wire. So there's no physical connection between the pilot and the controls and the engines and the ailerons and all those other magic things. So what they've looked at is that the more that pilots use the automated pilot, and I flew here for 9 hours from the UK, the pilot may be in control of the plane for less than 3 minutes of the 9 hours. They may do the takeoff and they may do the landing depending on the weather conditions. The rest of it, the automatic pilot flies. So far, so good. The pilot's refreshed. Doesn't it sound wonderful? Hopefully the pilot's not asleep. That's why they have two of them there, one to wake the other one up, hopefully. But the big problem comes when the computer doesn't know what to do next. There's a fairly famous flight. It's a flight from Brazil to Paris. It's an Airbus 330. It happened about 5 years ago. And it was a stormy conditions flying at night. Now I'm going to fly back tomorrow morning before dawn, probably. So this is fairly typical. I flew here at night. So they were flying at night. Weather for conditions not too good. In fact, it was really crappy. And there's something called a pitot tube, and it measures the airspeed. And you know when you look at the little thing and it says you're flying at 9,000 kilometers an hour, whatever, blah, 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 it's all wonderful. And we see the little moving map and the aeroplanes and the big ones. But essentially, it's used also to help control the engines and everything in the aeroplane. And something went wrong with it. And the computer essentially says, I don't know what speed we're flying at. I can't fly anymore. Over to you, pilot. Yippee! How's this feel to be a pilot at 33,000 feet in a storm, knowing you don't know what the airspeed is? What did the pilot do? Pull the stick back. What happens when you pull the stick back? The plane goes up. Trouble is the plane slows down. The plane went into a stall, went into the ocean, everyone dead. It took 5 years to find the black box, so about 300 people died. And the problem was they did a bunch of research afterwards and take pilots into the, I forget what you call it, but they practice in a sort of fake aeroplane. A simulator is the word for it. So they took them into the simulator and they found that after 6 weeks of not flying an aeroplane, the pilot has lost a lot of their competence to control the aeroplane. The pilots who had flown the old aeroplanes, like the Boeing 747s, which would fly by physical cables, had a long-term memory that helped them still fly, even if they hadn't flown for a long time. But newer pilots don't learn that. This book then looks at doctors. The same happens for doctors. In the UK, you have 7 minutes to greet the patient, diagnose a single fault, a single complaint. So you've got two complaints. I've got a cold and my leg's broken. We can do the cold or the leg, not both. Two appointments, go away. And in 7 minutes, they look on a computer, they come up, penicillin, you know, okay, you're gonna get 16 pills for penicillin, go. Oh, by the way, thank you very much for visiting. So they found again with medicine that doctors are now relying on computers more and more to make decisions, and there's less and less clinical knowledge. Now, in some cases, the computers are great. They can diagnose down to the genome level, but we're losing skills. It's happening in our industry. It's starting to, I'm working in a bank at the moment, and they order programmers by the tens. We need 40 of them. Skills, competence, good luck. So remember this, and remember that as human beings, we have a part to play, and that's part of the challenge. Now, I'm kind of out of time, but no one's stopping me yet. So let me give you this example. This is an example, and what we've got is an academic paper, and they're saying, essentially, each time there's a key press, these little red-ringed thingies, we have a little blue thingy, which is a network message. Is this a bug? We've got all the data we need here. We've recorded every key press. We've recorded all the things that's happening on the device, tons of traces. Is this a bug?
one, you're my computer. You're the algorithm. Is this a bug? Come on, you can give me a guess. I can't continue without you. Okay, thank you. Someone's bold enough to make a decision. It's a bug. What's the bug? There seems to be correlation. We know there's correlation, but we don't know what causation is. And the causation is really important. Most of us are used to using a search engine where, as we start typing, it starts giving us results that vary as we type. So if this is sort of Google search for a mobile device, perhaps it's exactly the right behavior. Every time we type a character, it sends a little packet to the server, and the server sends back new responses. This is what we want. If, however, this is an application that's sending every key press because it doesn't know what to do with it, perhaps this is a real bug that we've got in the application. It shouldn't be sending network messages until the end of something, like when we've completed the order form. The important thing is we don't know what it is, and human beings are very good at discerning what it is. We can look at the application, we can make some educated guesses on this. Again, I'll be very brief in terms of timing. This is talking about smart cities and smart homes. I happen to be at some talk on it. This bug is a bug in the Linux kernel called Dirty Cow. Most people heard of Linus Torvalds? So Linus Torvalds is the inventor of Linux. This bug was one he tried to fix 9 years ago and failed. And it came back last autumn. And I was thinking through this. If Linus Torvalds had problems fixing this bug 10 years ago, they eventually fixed it, by the way. Perhaps there's 10 people in the world who know how to deal with this. Is this our new world order, that all our testers need to be really brilliant people who are better than the machines and better than the programmers and all the rest of it? In which case, good luck to the rest of you. Yeah, maybe I'm the elite, but not even I count in this level. But also, this is a newspaper, 22nd of October in the UK. You know, if you look around here, there's probably little cameras in many of the rooms. Certainly, all the elevators have cameras in them. The foyers of the hotels have cameras. The airports are full of cameras. People buy the cameras at home so they can watch their little child. You know, when you're sitting bored at work, you can log in remotely to your IP thing, watch your child crawling around the floor. Well done, remote parenting. But perhaps you're also on holiday and you want to see whether someone's broken into your apartment or whatever. So far, so good. Over half the cameras are made by a single Chinese manufacturer. Trouble is that they're not hard to break into remotely. This is a list of passwords. There's a website of all the passwords of all the web cameras they know about, from A through Z, including people like Bosch, who you'd think would know better, Samsung. Hang on a sec, let me guess how long it's going to take me to work out a password of admin and 111111. Even I can't use Google to search for it. So what happened is millions of these were remotely controlled and told to all attack PayPal and try and take the site down. So this is the stuff I would like us to focus on. How can we design devices so that we don't have the stupidity of people installing them with default username and default password? It can be done. Maybe we should do so. I think I'm out of time, but you'll have the slides and you can read up about learning from medicine. The US are trying to reduce by $250 billion the cost of wasteful prescriptions of tests and medicines. Final thing I'll end with is I like cycling. The latest lights now have sensors in them that they can detect potholes in the road. Now, the only country I've not cycled in the world pretty much is India, because your holes beat my bicycles. But these can actually send back the data through your smartphones and give you a map of your city with the potholes. So with that, I'd probably better end and say, this is me, Julian. Thank you to these nice people. I'll probably have to take questions outside so the next speaker can come in, and I'll be around for the rest of the day. Thank you.